Hello everyone and welcome to our webinar. My name is Giri Tanetti. I run services for listed companies at ASX. To begin, I'd like to acknowledge that I'm hosting this event from the traditional lands of the Gadigal people and I pay my respects to elders past and present. I also acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands from which you all participate. I'd like to thank Aon and Ashurst for partnering with ASX for this event. They've provided the moderator and expert panellists, whom I'll introduce you to shortly. Before doing so, I just want to make a couple of housekeeping points. Please ask your questions in writing through the Q&A function. You'll see the button for that at the bottom of the screen. You can submit questions all throughout the panel and our moderator, Stephen, will either try and take them as they come in or save them for the end, depending on how they fit with the flow of the conversation. A recording of the event will be made available after the event has taken place. We'll let people who registered for the event know when that's available. There's also a QR code that we'll make available at the end of the event that will take you to the website where that will be posted. So the other way to get hold of the recording is just keep an eye out for that and scan the webpage. So it's now my great pleasure to introduce you to our moderator and panellists. The panel will be moderated by Stephen Trickey, Aon Australia's Financial Institutions Practice Leader. Stephen has a 31-year history with Aon. His first 11 years were spent in London as a financial lines insurance broker, which included the negotiation of directors and officers' liability and related insurances for a range of international clients. And he's undertaken a variety of different roles since moving to Australia in 2001. Stephen also works closely with Aon's Cyber Solutions Group in recognition of the increasing complexity and severity that cyber risk is presenting today. From Ashurst, we have insurance advisory partner Rahana Box, and in the litigation practice, we have Nick Mavrakis. Rahana is co-head of Ashurst's global insurance practice. She has particular expertise in D&O insurance and directors deeds and indemnity, and has advised many companies and directors on D&O related insurance for 25 years. Nicholas is a dispute resolution partner and global co-chair of the banking industry practice for Ashurst, with over 25 years experience managing large and complex commercial litigation, class actions, securities law disputes, regulatory investigations and civil penalty prosecutions. I omitted to cover off Eden Fletcher, who is also from Aon. And he's got 20 years experience in the insurance sector and leads Aon's financial lines practice in Australia. He's also a member of Aon's Global Financial Services Group Operating Committee. So a lot of expertise on this panel, and I'm sure you'll find the panel discussion enlightening. So that's all from me, I hope you enjoy the event. So welcome, Stephen.
Thank you, Giri, and good afternoon, everybody. Many thanks, Giri, for your kind introductions. And on behalf of today's panellists, I would also like to thank ASX for inviting us along to discuss this very important topic. And please, of course, as Giri's indicated, do ask your questions as we go through in the chat facility. So let's start by getting some background on how the liability and litigation environment has changed over time in Australia. I came to Australia 20 years ago, and I think at that time, you'd be scratching around to find examples of successful D&O liability claims. And regrettably, the situation now is altogether different. So turning to you first, Nick, can you please get us underway by giving us a short history lesson in how director duties and the liability landscape has evolved over time?
Thank you, Stephen, and welcome to everybody, and thank you for joining us. So I've been asked, as Stephen outlined, just to give a very plotted history of the greater role of the board that has emerged in the last 10 to 15 years, together with the expanded scrutiny that we've seen from ASIC as the corporate regulator and the rise of litigation funding and shareholder class actions. As to the director's duties, back in the sort of early 90s, we saw that the test for director's duty was focused on actual knowledge and actual conduct. And the focus really was what did the What are the obligations for directors to actually do, and what should they inform themselves about? That has evolved over time to an objective standard, and the test now really is what should the directors ought reasonably to have done or ought reasonably to have informed themselves about. And so what we've seen over the years is directors being pursued for the typical financial loss, continuous disclosure breaches, trading whilst insolvent. We have a lot of accounting breaches and the traditional sort of financial type breaches that we've seen ASIC pursuing and that we see in shareholder class actions. But the standard of care of directors we've seen evolve over time to match and meet community expectations. And particularly we saw that with the Banking Royal Commission and the APRA review of the banks, that we saw greater focus and scrutiny on boards to ask management the right questions, to challenge management, and to create strong cultures of compliance. And we've seen the role of the board expand into ensuring it has supervision over conduct risk within a company and non-financial risk. And more recently, we've seen a greater focus and scrutiny on ESG matters. And so the companies and boards are focused on cyber risk and climate change and greenwashing and ransomware. So, and there's an expectation by the boards and as the standard expands to focus upon being proactive in those areas. At the same time as we saw the evolution of the director's duties, we saw the rise of litigation funding, particularly following the seminal case of Fostiff in the High Court in 2006, which approved litigation funding, and we saw a raft of local and international funders enter the Australian market and become world leaders in funding, particularly shareholder class actions. And for the most part, with shareholder class actions, the funders and the plaintiff law firms really focus upon the company itself with the deep pockets. They tend to keep the cases simple. They tend to focus on less costs and principally because they want to eke out a settlement before the matter goes to trial, and it's much easier dealing with the company and its D&O insurers. But from time to time, we've seen directors being joined as defendants in those shareholder class actions or being joined as cross-claimants. And one study, I think, has found that about 25% of those shareholder class actions have directors joined. And I think the principal reason there is to get access to the D&O. This trend will continue. We've seen changes and reforms in Victoria introducing contingency fees. So that will be the way of the future. And finally, the role of ASIC has expanded over time from their deterrence perspective. We see them not only pursuing directors over a raft of different breaches and contraventions, but the way they have pursued the directors is becoming much more sophisticated. There are three principal ways they do that, and it does impact on the D&O policies. The first one is the stepping stones liability, where they seek to establish that the company itself breached the law, for example, the continuous disclosure provisions, and that the company breached the individuals breached their director's duty by failing to ensure the company complied with the law. The second example approach that ASIC takes, and we saw it yesterday in Get Swift. I haven't finished reading the judgment, but it's quite seminal. ASIC alleges that the directors are knowingly involved in the company's breach. So really focusing upon the conduct and the activities of the director in that particular case in approving the continuous disclosure notifications. And thirdly, again, we saw that in Get Swift, that ASIC does proceed directly against the individuals, the directors and officers for misleading or deceptive conduct. But it's not all doom and gloom. There are a raft of statutory defences, and when you focus upon some of the comments coming out of the Banking Royal Commission and the writings and the learnings of late, the board has a role to play in creating a strong compliance culture top down and testing management in relation to financial and non-financial risk and conduct risk and broader system procedures. And if they are followed, and if they're followed carefully, directors have available to them a raft of statutory defences, including the business judgment rule, the ability to rely upon others, including internal and external experts, which the directors often rely upon in the context of their day-to-day obligations, and of course, getting the benefit of court relief if they've acted honestly throughout their endeavours. So thank you for that, Stephen. Back to you.
Thanks, Nick. That is an incredibly helpful scene set, and I appreciate those remarks. Rahana, let's turn to your role and your practice at Ashurst. You're obviously asked to review the D&O insurance arrangements for a broad number of ASX-listed companies, which I imagine has been keeping you pretty busy recently. But can you give us a sense of what is typically causing the most anxiety for your clients, and what type of support and advice are you being asked to provide?
Thanks, Stephen. And it's an interesting question, because certainly I guess the focus has changed as the market has changed, and as I think most of the people on this call will recognise if they've been involved in D&O as a buyer for any period of time, that the market has significantly hardened over the last 5 years. So if you were talking to me 4 years ago, I would have said most of my work was really looking at policy wordings in detail, marking them up, and then working with the broker to try and get expansions and coverage. And that was my main role in relation to D&O. Now that conversation has changed quite significantly, and what I'm being asked to do most often is really look at the cover that's actually being bought and whether or not, in fact, it is actually necessary because of the cost of that cover that's being purchased, and also looking at whether or not there are issues in relation to a board, for example, in not continuing with certain covers. I think we might cover that a little bit later on. But one of the things to the areas that I am particularly being asked to look at is side C cover, and also increasingly side A cover. And I should just take a minute at this point just to explain what those concepts mean. Not everyone on the webinar today might actually understand that vernacular. So by convention, the three core covers of a D&O policy are referred to as sides A, B and C. A is the cover that side A is often called also the directors and officers liability cover, and that covers a director officer where they make a claim directly on the policy themselves. Side B is often also called company reimbursement, and it covers where a company has indemnified an insured person and then seeks to recover the costs of that indemnity from the insurer. Side C is often also called securities cover, and that covers it provides cover where there is a claim against the company in relation to a securities matter. So it is interesting just to make it just a couple of observations about those three covers before we move on. And first of all, that's that side A is triggered by, and B are triggered by, a claim against the insured person, whereas side C is triggered by a claim against the company. So that makes it slightly different between those covers. And secondly, side A is looking at protecting the director for their own personal liabilities, whereas sides B and C are protecting the company balance sheet. So again, there's a slightly different focus in relation to those covers. So you can buy side A, B and C together, and that's normally the basis of any main program, or then you're going up in layers, or possibly starting with an A, B as a primary, and then up to possibly an A only. So it's normally A, B, C or A, B, and then followed by an A possibly in the pyramid that might build up the program. So what I'm being asked for most, and I should just say one thing, whatever covers you buy, there'll be an aggregate limit that covers claims under all those sides that are covered in a particular layer of the policy. And that's an important point that comes up particularly in relation to what I'm often asked about, and that's around side C cover and whether or not that should be included. And certainly there is value in side C without a doubt, and that's probably why we're having this conversation now, because people have made so many claims under side C. It hasn't been good for insurers, but it's certainly for those insureds who've been able to claim, it has certainly shown its value. The issue for me, I think, is where it is included in a program where there isn't additional layers that are just side A, B or side A only. And that's that you do need to then be a bit wary that you are, in fact, diluting the cover that could potentially be available for claims against the insured persons themselves. And so that is a risk that needs to be weighed up against, again, the cost of including those additional layers, which I'm sure Eden's going to talk about in a moment. The final thing I'll just say is that the other trend I'm seeing, and I should say in most of those types of matters, the thing that I'm being asked to do most commonly is to provide reports in respect of the exposure of an entity, particularly in their particular area of where they're operating, two side C type claims, so that the board has some sort of indicators to form a judgment as to how much side C they should be buying. But the other thing that in recent times, I'm now being asked to also advise on whether or not there is side A cover is sufficient or is in excess of what's necessary. And that's a new sort of development. I think there hasn't been such a focus on side A before. But the things I would say about that very quickly are that, first of all, most directors also, first of all, would first look to indemnities from the company if they have a claim against them. So the side A coverage is really there in the event the indemnity doesn't respond, either because the company is insolvent or because the company can't indemnify for some reason. So it's not the first line of protection in the event the claim is brought against the director. And then you do need to also look at what cover is actually provided under the policy, which might be limiting the value of the side A cover. For example, it might exclude major shareholder claims. It certainly will probably exclude criminal fines and penalties. And it obviously won't help you against things such as banning orders, which are one of the common orders that might be made against a director where they are found in breach of various duties under the Corporations Act. And the final... And I was just going to say in relation to that, what I might be asked to do currently is really around reports on, again, what are the likely judgments and exposures for directors. And the one thing I'd say there is, looking at it historically, the judgments have not been that high. And the highest judgment I could find in recent times was approximately $7 million. But that also included $7 million of defence costs. And that... But that, even with that sort of level of looking at maybe $20 million being sufficient, a lot of side A limits are much higher than that. That doesn't, however, mean that's going to remain going forward, but that historically that there is some merit in looking carefully at the side A cover. And at that note, I'll hand back to Stephen.
Thanks, Rehana, in particular for unpacking the ABC vernacular, as we call it in the trade, I suppose. And it's an interesting point of view that on one view, we could perhaps suggest that side C has become a bit of a contaminant to the core intended cover. So we'll get to that in a moment. But let's change gears, Eden, and talk to you about the actual insurance market for D&O. Obviously, we've detected a lot of change in recent years. So perhaps you could help us understand the local and global marketplace environment we see here today. What are the prevailing market dynamics? And how on earth do we get from this flexible, sort of soft D&O insurance market or generous position to a more distressed and hard marketplace?
Yeah, thanks, Stephen. I'll probably tackle the second part of the question first. So I guess I'll firstly talk to some of the key factors that have directly influenced some of the very material changes to the D&O insurance market. I think firstly, one of the key factors relates to the construction of D&O policies and certainly how they've evolved over time. And this really goes to the heart of the side C phenomenon. I think it's important to recognise that these policies were originally designed to protect the interests of individual directors and officers. So originally, the only coverage that was afforded to companies under the policy was solely in respect of that company's indemnification obligations to those individuals. But as claims experience evolved, and this was primarily driven by securities claims in the US, insureds and their insurers had to deal with the issue of allocating covered versus uncovered loss under a D&O policy in circumstances where the company itself was also named in litigation. And given that the vast majority of securities claims in the US typically name both the company and certain directors, company coverage for security claims, so this is side C coverage, was introduced as a mechanism to deal with these allocation issues. I think it's important to note that this coverage was initially provided by insurers for little or no premium, and was seen by insurers as beneficial on the basis that it really allowed them to maintain conduct over the entire claim. But in terms of the Australian environment, it is a little bit different than other jurisdictions in that under Australian laws, a plaintiff hasn't needed to allege that misleading or deceptive conduct was committed by directors. And certainly under the ASX listing rules, there's no requirement that a company's failure to disclose to the market was deliberate or negligent. So what this means is there is a lower threshold for bringing securities claims against the company directly in Australia as compared to other jurisdictions. Such as the US, where intent is required. And certainly, as Nick mentioned, this nuance has resulted in the majority of securities claims in Australia being brought solely against companies. And these actions have certainly been largely funded by D&O insurers, which is arguably, you know, an unforeseen consequence of extending side C coverage to D&O policies. I think secondly, as Nick mentioned, you know, we've seen a material increase in plaintiff law firms focusing on securities class actions and very active litigation funders in this space. And certainly what we've seen as a result of that increase is arguably what represents more speculative claims, which is very problematic in an environment where few of these matters proceed to final judgment. Thirdly, up until about 4 or 5 years ago, and this is really important, the D&O insurance marketplace was awash with insurer capacity. And the level of insurer competition had a material effect of mitigating pricing increases. So what we've seen in recent years, however, is a contraction of global D&O capacity and very significant pricing increases as insurers look to remediate their portfolios. So, yeah, in the context of cumulative securities class action settlements in excess of $2 billion, the historical annual D&O premium pool of circa $250 to $300 million for Australian insureds was unsustainable. And finally, you know, the pandemic has really acted as a catalyst, hastening and intensifying change in what was already a hardening market environment. So insurer concerns around historical portfolio performance were overlaid with immense concerns around the economic downturn. And this certainly plays through the D&O insurance market in the context of securities claims, corporate insolvencies, and employment practices matters. In terms of the current market, I think as we enter Q4, I think pleasingly the D&O marketplace is starting to show signs of a more stable outlook. You know, whilst D&O rates do continue to face upward pressure, the rate of change is certainly easing relative to the last couple of years. And I'd probably caveat those comments by saying that insurer appetite does remain very constrained for COVID-19 impacted industries such as aviation, travel, tourism and hospitality, businesses with stressed financials and certainly businesses with governance concerns.
So it sounds from what you're saying, Ian, that there is a bit of light at the end of the tunnel. And, you know, if there are some sort of green shoots or promising signs of ease, what's giving life to that, those more easier times that we're hoping for our clients?
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly a few factors that are driving the current market environment. I think most insurers have executed their portfolio remediation strategies. And certainly after a period where underwriters had limited ability to navigate outside their actuarial model guidelines, we're now starting to see greater signs or greater levels of local authority. The total premium pool for Australian D&O business has grown dramatically over the past 3 or 4 years, increasing from that $250 to $300 million figure that I mentioned earlier, so now close to $1 billion per annum. So the historical insurer concerns relating to portfolio profitability are now arguably becoming less relevant off the back of significant pricing increases. And I think finally, with the growth in that D&O premium pool, we're seeing emerging new capacity coming to the marketplace, and this is primarily out of London. You know, this new capacity, whilst being cautiously deployed, I would emphasise, is providing additional options for insureds in what has been a capacity-constrained environment. And certainly as these new insurance markets have become more prevalent, traditional D&O insurers are being pushed to rethink their strategies and really engage more flexibly, especially on preferred risks.
Well, it sounds to me, Eden, as though side C is obviously the big challenge. And Rahana, obviously, we'll come back to the question of whether, you know, clients who remove side C cover, how that looks. But from that perspective, Rahana, if an organisation does remove their side C entity securities coverage from their D&O policy, could that actually have some unintended consequences or repercussions, given that directors also have duties to the company, obviously?
That's a really good question, Stephen. It's one I'm asked quite regularly by boards who are concerned that if they were to make a decision on side C, that they would somehow then find that itself constituting the breach of duty. And I think that is a reasonable question to ask, but I think that there is a lot of comfort to be had from the fact that provided the board is making a decision on the basis of, you know, making informed inquiries and good sound judgment in respect of the value for money that the cover is providing, just the fact of removing or reducing side C itself is not a breach of duty. And with some, depending on the sector that you're in, some of the premiums, really, you do have to question whether, in fact, taking outside sea might be a breach of duty in spending the money in that way, and whether it does represent, as I said, value for money.
Oh, thanks for clarifying that. That's a question we get a bit ourselves, of course. And Eden, so talking to that point, obviously, in particular, the onset of the pandemic and so forth, last year was a very hard year for D&O insurance purchases. What sort of trends have you been seeing in the Aon portfolio around either the continuance of that side sea cover or the all organisations that have voted with their feet, so to speak, and removed it from the policy?
Yeah, sure. A very good question. I think certainly based on our experience, senior leadership of ASX listed organisations can hold highly polarised views regarding the extent to which side sea cover should be included within the D&O program. And we're certainly spending a considerable amount of time with boards interrogating that point relative to the risk tolerance of the organisation. I think in relation to your question around statistics, based on the Aon portfolio, and I'll focus on the ASX 200 cohort, which is certainly where the lion's share of securities class action activity has been focused. Over the course of 2020 and 2021, we've seen side C limits purchased across that cohort of clients reduced by about 30%. So a very material change there. But I think probably the more important change from my perspective is as at the end of Q3 2021, about 28% of our portfolio of ASX clients don't or have ceased to purchase any form of side C coverage. I think it's also worth highlighting that headline D&O limits across the majority of these clients haven't materially changed. And certainly a number of these clients have reconfigured their programs by electing to convert all or some of that side C limit into an increased level of more affordable side A and AB coverages.
That's really interesting. So we'll come on to the composition of the policy in due course, but let's just change gears slightly to the continual disclosure regime change. And there's been a lot of discussion, of course, around or speculation around the potential impact the revision to the continuous disclosures law might have. Nick, can you firstly help us set the scene by explaining what has changed and how do you see that playing out in reality?
Thank you, Stephen. So the reforms that have been introduced, they were introduced through COVID and they've remained permanent now, is not to change the Section 674 or listing rule 3.1 test, but to actually make it more difficult to pursue the company and directors, either by ASIC or shareholder class action claimants, by introducing a no-fault regime and essentially to commence a civil penalty proceeding or a shareholder class action, you'll need to establish that the company acted intentionally or recklessly or negligently in failing to disclose information. And the aim there was, broadly speaking, from a policy perspective, to reduce the exposure of the companies and to reduce the exposure of directors. And so there is conjecture out there, as you mentioned, whether in fact that will occur. I'm not so sure myself for a couple of reasons. Firstly, the law hasn't changed. The obligations to disclose remain the same. They're critical obligations, and the company should have systems in place to make sure those obligations are triggered. But secondly, the test itself, if you unpack a shareholder class action claim, they're trying to determine whether the information was reasonably withheld. Now, that to me gets very close to a negligence claim, which is one of the fault elements you need to establish. And yes, there may be those matters on the fringe where from a cost-benefit analysis, some litigation funders may not wish to pursue. But I don't think you'll see a fundamental change in this area.
Okay, thank you, Nick. And Rahana, to yourself, I mean, does that mean that over time, perhaps, maybe not immediately, that side C cover will become less important or less critical in the composition of the policy? You're on mute, Rahana.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean I was on mute. Given what Nick has just said, I think the answer should be no. The risk is still there, and I don't think that the changes are significant enough to have a significant impact on the side seek value.
Well, question for Eden in that case. I mean, how are the insurers behaving around the change of disclosure laws? Are they offering any meaningful premium relief by virtue of that change?
Yeah, look, I think the reforms to the continuous disclosure laws is a positive development in respect of civil penalty proceedings. I think it does better align Australia with other jurisdictions. I think it will certainly be interesting to see whether the nature of securities claims changes, and certainly from the insurer perspective, a key area of focus is whether more of these claims seek to name directors in addition to the company, which as Nick mentioned, has historically not been the case. I think in response to your question, certainly no sign of premium relief at this stage. I think insurers will need to see tangible evidence of these changes having a positive impact on claims performance prior to making any wholesale changes to their underwriting approach.
Thank you, Eden. We might just turn into how we can make a meaningful difference in terms of optimising the D&O insurance process and the purchasing style, if you like. And I think it's obviously had to shift quite substantially over time, Eden. So what would be your sort of top three or four tips to organisations on the call that have been wrestling with this whole space for a while now and are looking somewhat perhaps anxiously at their next renewal campaign?
Yeah, sure. Look, I think the number one tip for me is to really plan ahead. I think clients need to adopt a very proactive approach and work in conjunction with their broker with a view to identifying and creating disruption strategies to optimise the outcome. So from that perspective, you know, we're typically commencing the renewal strategy process, you know, circa 6 months out from renewal. I think it's incredibly important to bring the board on the whole journey. And as I mentioned earlier, we're spending a considerable amount of time with boards to re-interrogate those historical purchasing decisions relative to their own risk appetite. So from an Aon perspective, you know, we're taking historical securities class action claims data and overlaying with client-specific metrics such as market cap, stock volatility, share register, liquidity position, industry, regulatory environment, and the increasing costs of obviously defending litigation to create more meaningful loss modelling. And really, this is helping our clients better understand how big their D&O loss exposure might be in addition to informing risk retention strategies. I think it's really important to go through this decision-making process with the board early and set the strategy prior to engagement with the insurance market. Certainly, insurer choice is extremely important, and clients should work with their broker to identify strategic insurer partners. I think to that end, in a tight marketplace, it's certainly not in your interest to run a Dutch auction. It will only work against you. So with that in mind, it really is key to formulate a comprehensive insurer engagement strategy, including how you leverage any cross-class relationships, and really focus on understanding an insurer's full value proposition. I think it's important to recognise that we have seen signs of claims paying willingness changing off the back of insurer profitability challenges. And certainly from an Aon perspective, we're using data and analytics around claims capabilities in particular to help inform that insurer engagement process. We're also using data and analytics to help inform the go-to-market strategy and help identify the best jurisdiction to access a particular insurer. I think the reality is the Australian insurance market has had an over-concentration to some very Australian-specific issues, such as securities claims and certainly losses associated from the Financial Services Royal Commission. So we're monitoring insurer behaviour globally and accessing markets in other regions with a view to really leveraging a more global premium pool and a global view. And I think this strategy is also really important to facilitate better engagement with key decision makers at insurers. And I think probably one tip in terms of just presentations, I think it's also worth highlighting that insurers that are now keenly focused on emerging liabilities relating to ESG. So we really recommend that organisations clearly articulate the practical application of their governance frameworks to address emerging risks. And certainly of topical interest to D&O insurers is mandating of employee vaccinations. So companies should be prepared to educate insurers of their position with respect to employee vaccinations, including their risk-based assessment that defines that employee vaccination strategy.
So talking of vaccinations and all things COVID, we've had a question come through on the Q&A facility, which is around how COVID has either directly or indirectly affected the landscape for D&O insurance.
Yeah, sure. Look, I think in the current environment, I mean, corporate insolvencies are probably the biggest concern for insurers, which is naturally aligned with the pandemic and global economic downturn. You know, we are seeing significant focus by insurers on capital raisings in particular. I think during the pandemic, you know, a lot of companies have been raising capital and many insurers are incorporating stricter policy provisions to ensure that they have the opportunity to effectively underwrite those raisings. So the rationale and requirement for a company raising capital is being heavily scrutinised by underwriters. I think in the context of COVID, certainly new working dynamics are also relevant. You know, we've been working from home. There's been a significant increase in mental health related issues and many companies have sought to downsize staff during the pandemic. So how that links through the D&O policy, it obviously heightens potential for employment practices related claims.
Okay, whilst on the questions, we had another one which I think relates back to composition of the policy. And I think this was a little bit touching on the area that you were alluding to, Rahana, around the levels of A, B and the C. The questions are along the lines of, what's the optimum composition of the right D&O policy? Now, I suspect you're going to say to me, there's no one size fits all, but perhaps we can sort of try and unpack that and the kind of topics that Eden was touching on around board appetite.
Yeah, that's quite an interesting question. And certainly I would see for any company that is including size C in their program, it is very, I think personally, it's important to also have another layer that's at least just AB and possibly even just a side A only cover in relation. So there is some part of the overall limit that's being purchased for the program that is solely there for the benefit of directors' claims and can't be completely exhausted by claims against the company under a securities action. In relation to how that structure, that really depends, as you say, on things like risk appetite. There is issue too that a lot of entities are effectively self-insuring a large portion, certainly of the side C part of the program now, side B, by having significantly higher deductibles than they had previously. Sometimes that's because of a choice, sometimes that's because the insurers are requiring that, or it's a combination of both. So there is also sort of almost another layer coming in of self-insurance that can be relatively significant, particularly on side C, where I've seen $5 million deductibles, for example, and sometimes higher. So the structure of the program is changing. I don't think you can say there's any ideal sort of structure in respect of how those layers in relation to relative size. Although I would say, going back to my earlier comment in relation to side A, I guess it may well fall out of an analysis of what the actual legal potential liability is of side A claims. And that can sort of certainly factor into the decision as to how much additional side A, side B to buy.
Thanks, Rahana. Now, we've got another point I know you'd like to make before we circle back to our questions. And I think this is really talking about some of the top tips of how to change the emphasis of how you present to D&O insurers, Rahana. And I think the question to you is really, I suppose, in your capacity as the senior partner of the firm that buys insurance for Ashurst on a global basis, perhaps you could comment as the buyer on the call.
Sure. No, that's a nice change to be now talking as buyer. And that's one of the, I think, the benefits in my role is I do. I am actually also not just an advisor, but also a buyer. And I've been placing the Ashurst Global Program and Blake Dawson before that for more than 20 years now. So I am in the market as a buyer with my broker, Aon, trying to getting the best deal. So we spend a lot of time every year working on our presentations to the market, and we spend a lot of time getting to know all our insurers on our market, on our program for our key insurances, not just the underwriters, but in other key insurances, also some of the claims people, so that people understand us and know us. And I think that's been invaluable to us in relation to getting the best sort of placement offers in respect of our program. And in some cases, I'm absolutely sure we would not have got the capacity we did, but for the fact of the relationships we've built with the market over time. One of the messages I often give to people internally within the firm, and I'm happy to share that, is that, you know, we've got to treat our insurers as silent partners in our business. They're taking our risk for a certain percentage of our profit, and that we have to show that respect in respect of then allowing them into our tent, explaining how we do things, getting them comfortable that we're someone they want to be in a relationship with of this nature. part of that, it does include also bringing other people into that discussion. It's not just myself. I'm often bringing people from other areas of the business that are particularly of interest. ESG was mentioned, and we have our own ESG programs. And you're bringing potentially, depending on the type of business you are, you're bringing in your chairman, your NEDs, your GC, possibly your IT cyber people, health and benefits people, all come into play now just to show and to actually develop the confidence of the insurer that you're well managed across the board, that you're on top of issues, that you're being proactive, not reactive, so that you can elicit the best offers back from the market at the time of renewal. And the other thing I would say is it's really important to have those relationships before a claim arises. No one wants a claim, but that's what insurance is there for, and there is always the potential that you will have a major claim. You don't want to be sitting across the table from, and the claims people, and it's the first time you've met your insurers. And I've had many clients who've been in that situation. It's much, much better if you've developed a relationship over time so that you're talking to someone you know, who knows you, you've got a relationship, you've got that they've made, promises to you over time, and you've made promises to them, and hopefully you can then both abide by the spirit of those previous discussions and agreements.
Yes, a really solid tip about requesting the support of chair and other non-executive directors to really, I suppose, demonstrate to insurers governance in action. So that's a good tip. Now, we've had a couple of other questions, one relating to the class action environment. I'm going to try Nick on this one. The question is, he would appreciate some commentary on the status of class action opt-in versus opt-out.
Well, that's an area of conjecture. the law is still developing, and it's also developing around common fund orders, and that area hasn't been resolved as between the High Court and the Federal Court and the various state Supreme Courts. But it is a way that the funders manage their risk, and in particular, avoiding the free rider issue. And that will continue to remain a risk, particularly as there is still an uncertainty between the Federal Court of Australia and the Supreme Court about opt-out notices. And that still is yet to be resolved, whether you can unilaterally send out an opt-out notice. And if there is no response by a claimant, whether it's a shareholder class action or otherwise, whether that right is automatically voided. And that area needs to be resolved in due course. There are some class actions presently on foot where that may be taken to the Federal Court, or the full Federal Court in particular, or the High Court. But until that is resolved, you will continue to have the free rider issue, which actually is problematic if you're being sued, because you want to get certainty when you settle that you have captured all the class. And it's more relevant, of course, outside of shareholder class action claims, but other product claims where you do want certainty around closure of the class.
Thank you, Nick. I'm going to stay with you, Nick, because we've had a question around continuous disclosure, which I suspect was inevitable, around the kind of disclosure practices that can minimise class actions. So we'll start there. And a secondary question I might go to Eden is, what kind of exclusions might an insurer put in place if they're not comfortable with a company's disclosure practices? So might start with you, Nick, first, around what practical steps can organisations take to minimise class action exposure regarding disclosure practices, please?
The first thing I ask for is the continuous disclosure policy. And I see if it's being not just on the shelf, but actually, is it a live document? Is it being updated? Because a decision whether or not to disclose to the market is one of judgment, you really look at the pieces of paper which inform that judgment, and you make sure that the specialists within the organisation, if it's an accounting issue, an impairment issue, if it's a forecast issue, you make sure you've got the right experts, the CFO or otherwise, who have put down their view of the facts and the judgment and the decision carefully. You make sure that you've got an audit trail of those decisions, and you make sure it gets elevated through management, up through the CEO, CFO, through the executives and up to the board. And so what you want to see all the way down is a robust policy, but it actually works in practice. and that there are minutes or otherwise a documentary trail evidencing very clearly the decision whether or not to disclose. And one thing that I've seen that does emerge in the cases is there is something that is bubbling around below the surface, whether it's an issue about a particular forecast or whether it's an accounting issue that hasn't been elevated to the right people. So one thing that continuous policy disclosure policy should have is sort of a robust process to ensure all relevant facts have been elevated, because the last thing you need is 2 years down the track, with the benefit of hindsight, a plaintiff law firm or the regulator finds some corners and emails that haven't been disclosed, which contain facts which were relevant to that judgment. So it's really, in summary, Stephen, looking at having robust policies in place. And again, going back to what we've all learned, a strong compliance culture.
So thank you, Nick. That's helpful. And so, Eden, what happens if it doesn't look as good as it should look in terms of the insurer's behaviour around either modifying or restricting or limiting cover? What sort of attitudes do you find?
Yeah, sure. I mean, my response is unfortunately going to be a little bit binary. I think in that type of scenario, it's not really about exclusionary language being imposed. I think rather, you know, the insurance market is such that underwriters are very prepared to walk away from organisations whose profile or risk profile, in their opinion, doesn't fit their risk appetite. So I think to Rahana's point, you know, this places greater importance on how companies showcase and highlight their approach to governance, risk management and compliance.
Very good, very good. Now, thank you for that. We've had a couple of questions relating to prospectus exposure, presumably rising mostly out of a capital raising situation. And I think they're sort of interrelated. So I'll try, Eden, you first, and ask Rahana's comments as well. So what trends, Eden, are you seeing with regards to companies including prospectus insurance in the D&O cover within an IPO environment and a raising environment, I suppose?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think I talked to the market views around capital raisings before. I think, you know, certainly we're not seeing a prevalence of organisations adopting standalone prospectus liability cover. And really what's driving that is the availability of capacity in the marketplace. So generally speaking, most clients are looking for cover for any capital raisings under the D&O policy. But I think to Rahana's point, certainly worth considering how that impacts the risk profile of the organisation and how that flows through to limits that need to be in place to protect the interests of the individual directors and officers. Certainly from an IPO perspective, I mean, the market does continue to be quite challenged. We have seen some cases of newly listed organisations over the course of the last 18 to 24 months pursuing D&O cover without cover for the offer document itself. I think the decision making process around that is clients looking at the exposure that's associated with that document. Are there forecasts in place, et cetera, et cetera. I think certainly the decision not to include cover relates to that risk profile, but also a decision making process around how do we contain costs as part of the D&O process. I think probably the comment that I'd make is I'd be very cautious around not including cover for the IPO or the PDS under a D&O policy, as claims over the course of the first sort of 2 to 3 years whilst you're a listed organisation are very, very likely to link back to any representations that are made in that document.
So I would imagine, Rahana, you get this question quite a bit. I mean, what's your view of the world around this topic of foregoing cover for the prospectus? It sounds like a pretty risky game, that.
Absolutely. It wouldn't be something I would ever advise. Certainly in that particular situation, it's one of probably the highest risk areas in relation to making disclosures to the market. And certainly one where I would recommend anyone, certainly to the extent it's available, look to get cover that's extended under their existing D&O or under a standalone IPO policy if that's available and can be put in place in the time available. I was involved in one matter a year ago where we had to put one in place very quickly for an IPO, and it did cause a lot of stress for everybody because it was so hard to put in place. It had been left to one side. And it certainly wasn't a happy pace for anybody involved in that particular transaction in trying to get that, that cover at the last moment. One thing I would say in relation to that is that it is also a very specialised area of cover. And if you are seeking specific cover for IPOs, sometimes you might need to make sure that the broker that you're using also has experience in placing this sort of cover, because not every broker has that experience. And that, that certainly was in that particular case. We actually, the client I was involved with, changed brokers at the last moment to actually get the cover.
Thank you, Rahana. We've got a couple of quite specific questions. I think the first one's probably for you, Rahana. So what role could or should not a captive insurance company take in the in relation to D&O insurance?
Okay, that's a good question too, and it's one I've had a few times, especially at the moment when people are all looking at captives just generally because of the cost of insurance, not just in D&O, but more broadly. The issue with using a captive for D&O is in Australia in particular, at Section 199A in particular of the Corporations Act, but also other legislation where there are restrictions on a company indemnifying its directors and officers. And often that, that usually in legislation extends to related bodies corporate. If you've got a captive that's and some captives are set up as companies within the group, then that is a related body corporate, and so it can't indemnify the director or officer for those things which the company itself can't indemnify that director or officer. So it does take away, it really basically means that the side A cover can't be substituted, commercial side A cover can't be substituted by a policy written through a captive. You'll end up with a larger gap than otherwise. The other issue is that sometimes people then look at using what's called a protected cell captive. So people are basically rent a captive. You buy a cell within an existing captive to provide the captive services. And that they're set up in particular jurisdictions which allow for these cells to operate independently and not to infect each other in respect of liabilities. Or people have talked to me also about DMFs. The issue with both of those type of arrangements is that the restrictions, say, for example, in the Corporations Act also extend to providing the cover through an interposed entity. So in relation to the captive cell, which is funded by the company, and also in relation to a DMF, which is funded by the members, both those types of arrangements will likely fall foul of those restrictions as well. So basically you can use side, you can use a captive or a protected cell company for sides B and C, but not for side A.
So I should, my bad, I should have gotten back a bit and explained for a vernacular check. One of the questions we've had is, what is a captive, please?
Oh, yeah. a captive is, if it's a company, it's a group company that basically provides insurance to other entities within the group and other persons within the group. And that captive, it can be set up for various reasons, probably not the time to go into it here. But it's basically the group's own insurer. A protected cell is sort of a facility that's used through an existing company to provide the same function.
And a DMF is discretionary mutual fund, if I'm not mistaken.
Mutual fund, correct. That's right. And so there are discretionary mutual funds in Australia, and they're being talked about for various areas at the moment because of the especially in professional indemnity and other areas, because of the hard insurance market. So it's where a group of people basically get together, and they're members of a mutual. And you're basically funding each other's losses and liabilities. It can be set up so that the cover has to, however, be discretionary. To be a discretionary mutual, it can't be an absolute right to cover. It's a bit more. There's a bit more to go into that. It's a bit hard in this.
Understood.
This form.
Yeah, it sounds very complicated. I suppose, like anything in life, it's really a question of be careful what you wish for if you aren't really sort of conducting a deep dive feasibility study around some of those alternatives. We've got one more quite specific question, which might just leave a couple of minutes to wrap up. A question relating to receiving our renewal terms, and what is the minimum or maximum percentage increase that we've seen in respect to increasing the policy excesses or deductible levels? I might try Eden on that one, if I may.
Yeah, sure. A very good question, and probably a difficult one to answer, if I'm honest. Look, I think I mentioned that the insurance market has really focused on its remediation strategies, and that certainly applies to deductible levels as well. I think where we've seen a lot of that remediation is around side C retentions or deductibles. So I'd candidly say that certainly if you had side C deductible movement over the course of the last couple of years, which I expect you have, that it's probably fair to say that level of deductible should probably stay where it is this year. Where we're seeing insurers really focus their attention at the moment is around the extent of adequacy of side B deductibles. I think certainly off the back of remediation strategies, the side B deductibles are an area that insurers haven't really focused on. So certainly I'd be conscious of the fact that that's where they're going to turn their attention to this year. And this relates to concern that, you know, there'll be more claims against directors. It's obviously the environment that we've talked about, in a pandemic related environment, and employment practices type claims, et cetera, et cetera. So I think a difficult one to answer in terms of what sort of percentages. I think it depends on the size of your organisation, sort of the industry that you're in, et cetera, et cetera. But I'd probably focus on the side B deductible this year as being an area of concern.
And sorry, Rohani, yes, please, carry on.
Just to clarify, because people might not realise that under D&O policies, the side A cover generally has no deductible.
Yes.
And fortunately, that hasn't yet been sort of, I think, attacked to my knowledge, and hopefully it won't. So with the side A claim, this issue doesn't come up.
No, thank you for that clarification, Rohana. And I suppose, Eden, it really is a question of be careful you don't volunteer an increase of excess to your insurer, because they might not necessarily give you the premium relief you would hoped for. But I think that's probably, with 2 minutes to go, unless there's any more questions that I can see, no, I can't, on the Q&A, I might ask Giri to come back on the call and see if she'd like to, with 1 minute to go, conduct a short wrap. But I'd like to certainly thank my fellow panellists for their participation this afternoon. Giri?
Thank you, Stephen, and a big thank you to the whole panel. That was an incredibly informative and really useful discussion. I've already received a lot of positive feedback about it over the Q&A. This session will be available on our website. As I mentioned earlier on, we will send an email within the next week or so to all registrants and give them the location of the recording on our website. In the meanwhile, still got some feedback coming in there. Thank you everyone for attending. We had a really good rollout. Now, this is the QR code I alluded to before. If you scan that, it takes you to the place where our previous education sessions are already stored, our previous webinars, and where this one will go up. And if you have any inquiries at all, our email address for responding to these matters is listed at asx.com.au. So thanks again, and see you all soon, I hope.
Thank you.
Thanks.